Good morning, my dear seniors, teachers, colleagues and friends. Today I am going to talk about female genital tuberculosis. Considering the fact that just 1 week back was the World Tuberculosis Day, 24th of March, and WHO's slogan for this year was "United we stand to end tuberculosis." Tuberculosis is an ancient malady that has been plagued humanity for more than 70,000 years. A disease indistinguishable from tuberculosis has been mentioned in Ayurveda. The first recorded case of tuberculosis in female genital organs was described by Mogadni in the year 1744 in an autopsy. Coming to the global burden, 1/3 of the world population is infected, and the lifetime risk of tuberculosis after infection is 5 to 10%. With 10 million new cases and 3 million deaths per year, WHO declared tuberculosis as a global emergency in 1993, and the disease burden in India alone is about 14 million cases. Though pulmonary tuberculosis is the commonest and the most infectious form, extrapulmonary tuberculosis is being increasingly encountered throughout the world. Genitourinary tuberculosis is the commonest site of extrapulmonary tuberculosis, and female genital tuberculosis accounts for about 50% of genitourinary tuberculosis. Female genital tuberculosis is an important cause of significant morbidity. Short and long-term sequelae can especially lead to infertility. Timely diagnosis, a prompt and appropriate treatment may prevent infertility and other sequelae of the disease. Coming to the topic proper. So, in India, the incidence of female genital tuberculosis ranges from 1 to 19%, and it is about 3 to 16% in infertile patients. In developed countries, the reported cases are around 1%. The incidence is on rise due to increasing HIV infection, poor compliance with the long treatment, and emergence of drug-resistant species. Coming to etiology, it is mostly secondary to pulmonary tuberculosis or some focus in extragenital regions. Primary sources can be lung in 50% of cases, lymph nodes in 40%, genitourinary tract in 5%, skeletal system in 5%, others being GI tract, meninges, and miliary tuberculosis. The spread can occur either to hematogenous, lymphatic, or direct extension from the peritoneum, and rarely infection of the vulva and vagina can occur by an infected semen. First organ usually to be involved is fallopian tubes. About 90 to 100% of cases, fallopian tubes are involved. Next comes the endometrium, 50 to 80%, ovaries about 30%, then the cervix 5%, and rarely vulva and vagina up to 1 to 5%. Coming to fallopian tubes, so more than 90% of cases of genital tuberculosis presents with fallopian tube infection is bilateral in majority of the cases, and it can present as perisalpingitis, interstitial salpingitis, or endosalpingitis. Perisalpingitis is usually an extension of tubercular peritonitis where the external surface of the tube is affected. The thickened, rigid tube with tubercles on surface with dense pelvic adhesions can be noted. Interstitial salpingitis is the most common. Here the muscular layer is affected. It is commonly known as salpingitis isthmica nodosa. And endosalpingitis presents as the pyosalpinx, or known as the floating or giant pyosalpinx. Here, early closure of the abdominal ostium leads to collection of caseous material within it, giving it a tobacco pouch or the male pouch appearance. Coming to the endometrium. Endometrium affected by tuberculosis can present either as tubercular endometritis, where basal endometrium is destroyed, leading to intrauterine adhesions, or it can be a tubercular pyometra. This is usually seen in postmenopausal females, where cervical affection causes cervical stenosis, leading to pyometra. Ovarian tuberculosis, here either the surface of the ovary is affected, it has a direct extension from the peritoneal capital fallopian infection, or hematogenous route, or during ovulation, where ovarian parenchyma can be involved. In all the cases, patients usually present with TO mass, tubo-ovarian masses. Cervix, it usually is secondary to tubal or endometrial lesions, and They present as ulcers, usually soft yellowish flow with undermined edges is characteristic, but sometimes hypertrophic lesions can be seen. Vagina and vulva are rarely infected, and it is usually through the direct semen infection. Coming to the clinical features, most of the cases present with infertility, but up to 11% can be asymptomatic. There can be general systemic symptoms like fever, anorexia, weight loss, and poor general condition. Infertility is the most common presentation of female genital tuberculosis. It may be due to the tubal, ovarian, or the uterine factors. 50% of the patients present with menstrual disturbances, which range from normal cycles to oligo or hypomenorrhea, and then progress to amenorrhea. Then there can be menorrhagia due to pelvic condition. Puberty menorrhagia, about 4% of puberty menorrhagia cases can be due to tuberculosis. Then dysmenorrhea, menorrhagia, and metrorrhagia if ulcers are present. And last, postmenopausal bleeding. So all the presentations of gynecological condition can be seen in tuberculosis. Pain. Pain can be acute or chronic. Acute abdomen can be due to rupture of a tube or abscess or flare-up of the infection following procedures like HSC, DNC, and even following coitus, exercise, and menstruation. Whereas chronic abdominal or pelvic pain usually presents as way lower abdominal pain, which is constant, and it may increase with secondary infection. Vaginal discharge presenting as leucorrhea, this is due to pelvic condition, or it can be bloodstain discharge in presence of endometriosis or cervical ulcers. Unusual symptoms include ulcers in vulva or vagina, labial swelling, urinary retention, and fecal incontinence. Coming to signs, there may be no signs at all, or fever, lymphadenopathy, auscultatory findings in the chest, as it's the most common primary locus. Then other systemic signs depending on the extrapulmonary tuberculosis site. Abdominal examination, abdomen may feel doughy, there can be signs of peritonitis, there may be ascites, or presenting with mass per abdomen. Vaginal examination, we can see vulval, vaginal, or cervical lesions, and on perimenial examination, uterus may be normal or slightly enlarged if there is pyometra. Adnexal tenderness or induration can be noted. Adnexal mass or TO ovarian masses can be seen, or fullness or tenderness in POD can be felt. For rectal examination, we may find small nodules in the POD. Unusual signs include hypertrophic and ulcerative lesions of the cervix, vagina or vulva, labial masses, and fistulas, which can be vesicovaginal, rectovaginal, tubovesical, tuboperitoneal, tubointestinal, or uterocutaneous. Coming to differential diagnosis. No organ in the body is spared of tuberculosis except hair and nail, which has not been reported till now. Because of its generalized and also systemic manifestations, any disease you mention from head to toe, it can be a differential diagnosis to tuberculosis. Depending on the clinical presentation, when they present with acute pain, you can think of appendicitis, cystitis, pyelonephritis. Pain with adnexal mass can be due to ectopic pregnancy, torsion or rupture of adnexal mass, again appendicular mass or diverticulitis, endometriosis, and ovarian cancer. Granulomatous lesions in pelvis can be ED for syphilis, actinomatosis, leprosy, and other granulomatous diseases. Ulcerative or hypertrophic lesions in the vulva, vagina, or cervix can be a differential diagnosis for CA cervix. There can be abscess or condyloma acuminata, elephantiasis, lymphogranuloma, and warts. Coming to diagnosis. Because it is a paucibacillary in nature and variety of clinical presentation, eliciting good history takes a very important step for diagnosis. So it starts with eliciting presenting complaints, history of tuberculosis or having taken treatment for tuberculosis in the past, family history of tuberculosis or treatment in a close family member, history of being HIV positive, detailed general physical examination, systemic examination, and then followed by investigations. Genital tuberculosis is suspected if there is an evidence of chronic pelvic inflammation in virgin, which is resistant to ordinary methods of treatment. This was a dictum. Early diagnosis is crucial for timely treatment and prevention of fibrosis and hence long-term sequelae, especially infertility. Diagnostic dilemmas arise due to varied clinical presentation and diverse results and imaging and endoscopy, so high index of suspicion is required. Being a possibly disease, demonstration of mycobacterium tuberculosis is not possible in all cases. Hence, a battery of bacteriological, serological and histopathological tests are required to gain a collective evidence to diagnose genital tuberculosis. The diagnostic tests available can be broadly classified into direct methods which help us in detecting mycobacterium tuberculosis in the specimens, or they can be indirect methods which help in noting the tissue changes caused by the infection, so give indirect evidence of the disease. Because of the possibility nature, we do need a combination of both direct and indirect methods to come to conclusion. Coming to investigations, complete hemogram shows non-specific changes like anemia, leukocytosis, lymphocytosis and elevated ESR. X-ray tests can be done to search for primary focus. Multiple test is of limited use, sensitivity being only 55% and specificity 80%. And considering the fact that one third of the population is infected with tuberculosis, false positives are very high. So to get better results, now we have ICRA or the 24-hour TB gold test, where diagnosis of latent tuberculosis is done. It is a rapid immunodiagnosis method. It detects interferon gamma released by mononuclear cells in the ELISA format. It is not affected by the previous BCG vaccination status and has high specificity, but availability is limited. Coming to serological tests, they are neither sensitive nor specific to be of diagnostic value. Hence, it is being planned to be banned. Coming to blood markers, CA125 can be moderately raised, but it is raised in many gynecological and non-gynecological conditions, so specificity is very less. Coming to microscopy, culture and histopathological examination. Specimens obtained in female genital tuberculosis is usually from menstrual blood. Usually, ideal period will be from 24th to 26th day of the premenstrual cycle, but in case she comes with the onset of menstruation, we can still take samples up to 12 hours of the onset of menses. Endometrial biopsy, either as an inpatient or an outpatient procedure, this should be taken in the late premenstrual period. And also, if secretions from vagina, cervix, peritoneal or tubal biopsy are available, they can be sent for examination. Histopathological study. Here the specimen is sent in a formalin solution. Granulomatous epithelioid changes with Langerhans-Jane cells and with central caseation is characteristics of tuberculosis. Coming to culture, the LJ culture and Bactec culture are available. Of this, Bactec 460 is more superior. Considering that only 100 Bacilli per ml is enough and sensitivity is 80 to 90%, and result is obtained by 5 to 10 days, unlike LJ culture which takes 6 weeks. Bactec 460, besides giving diagnosis, it also useful for drug susceptibility testing, so diagnosing multi-drug resistant tuberculosis. Other rapid diagnostic tests which are available for drug sensitivity are mycobacterial growth inhibitor tube and specific gene probes. Coming to polymerase chain reaction, it is a very sensitive, rapid and less specific method. It can detect as less as 10 bacilli per ml, but and give results within 1 to 2 days. But there can be false negative results due to contamination with heparin or high salt concentration of the sample. It is expensive, complex, the high false positive rate, and it cannot differentiate between viable and dead bacteria. So, as an innovation and modification to overcome all these shortcomings is now CBNAT or the Gene Expert TB. It is endorsed by WHO. It is a hemi-nested cartridge-based real-time PCR. It is now available in all the government institutes and RNTCP centers, and this test is done freely. Outside, it costs about 3,000 rupees. So here, minimum of 131 colony-forming units per ml is enough, and you get a result within 2 hours, less than 2 hours, that is 1 hour 45 minutes. This is how it is done. The sample obtained is mixed with a reagent for liquefaction. Then 2 ml of this reagent is added into a cartridge. Then this cartridge is inserted into the test platform. Here ends the manual work. Rest of the process is done by the machine. So human error is not there. It includes automatically filtering and washing then capturing the organism to release DNA, then mixing it with the dry PCR agents, then amplification and detection, and the result comes out in a printed format like this at the end of 1 hour 45 minutes. So a simple lab technician can do it and expertise is not required. There are a number of disadvantages though. The shelf life of the cartridge is only 18 months and a very stable electricity supply is required. Instrument needs to be recalibrated annually. The cost of the test, I told you, it costs about 3,000 rupees. And the temperature ceiling is critical. To overcome this, now Gene Expert Omni and Gene Expert Ultra are under trials. They may soon be replacing the original cartridge. Coming to imaging methods. Ultrasonography is a non-invasive method. It diagnoses ascites and loculated collections in 100% of cases, adnexal masses in 93%, endometrial involvement, especially when SIS is done, 83%. Also, peritoneal thickening and omental thickening can be diagnosed. CT scan, MRI, and PET scan are optional investigations to be done only in certain specific clinical scenarios where it may help us to decide whether surgical option to be considered or not. CT scan is useful. It can show pelvic or abdominal masses with low density, ascites, multiple pelvic, abdominal, hepatic or splenic lesions, and lymphadenopathy can be detected. MRI has better resolution than CT, no risk of radiation, and we may avoid laparotomy as usually the differential diagnosis from the ovarian malignancy. Presence of hypodense masses with limb enhancement abutting the pelvic walls is suggestive of tuberculosis. PET scan, it is done only when you already have diagnosed it to be genital tuberculosis. It will help us to know only if lesion is active or not, that's all. Coming to histosalpingography. It is an invaluable investigation to evaluate the internal architecture of the female genital tract. Various abnormalities depending on the involvement and severity of the disease can be seen. And in a known or suspected case of genital tuberculosis, this procedure is contraindicated as it can flare up the disease. This is a normal HSC, you can see the normal uterine contour, the tubes are normal and there is peritoneal spillage showing that the tubes are patent. HSC findings, there can be tubes may appear straight or rigid, pipe stem appearance, venous or lymphatic intravasation is strongly suggestive of tuberculosis, obstruction of fallopian tube in the zone of transition between isthmus or ampulla can be there. There can be regular calcifications in the fallopian tube. Multiple constrictions or beaded appearance may be there. Ragged or jagged tuber contour with small luminal defects and fistula tracts. Depending on the extent of involvement, one or a combination of all these can be noted in the HSC films. Here we can see a sperm head appearance of the tube. This is the lead appearance. Here there is bilateral corneal block with intravasation of the dye. Similarly, here there is bilateral corneal block and intramyometrial intravasation. This is called as a blue uterus. Here there is bilateral terminal hydrosalpinx with right tube showing some nodularity here. Here there is left terminal hydrosalpinx with the right corneal block. Intravasation of dye can be seen here with left terminal hydrosalpinx. Bilateral corneal block with intravasation of dye into the vessels and lymphatics can be noted here. There is bilateral tubo-ovarian masses, bilateral hydrosalpinx, and sometimes this is salpingitis systemica nodosa. This is a typical affection of the myometrium and also the muscular layer of the tube. Sometimes HSG may give us a differential diagnosis of uterine anomalies like this. It appears as a bicornate uterus and this appears as a unicornate uterus. But you can see there is extravasation of the dye and dilatation of the cervical canal which suggests tuberculosis. And this was the pre-op HSG and this is the post-op specimen. Coming to endoscopy, which includes hysteroscopy and laparoscopy. Hysteroscopy may show normal cavity with bilateral open ostium, small shrunken cavity, pale endometrium as you can see here, partially or completely obliterated cavities with adhesions, which may grade from grade 1 to grade 4 depending on how much of the cavity is obliterated. Laparoscopy offers a dual advantage of both pelvic organ visualization and specimen collection for otherwise inaccessible sites. Specimen should be subject to staining, microscopy for AFP, culture and drug susceptibility testing and histopathology. Here we can see pallor of the tissue because of endarterectus obliterans. There can be dense adhesions. Tubercles may be seen on the peritoneal cord. Calcifications can be seen. Caseous material can be noted. Nodular or patchy salpingitis can be there. This is a picture showing left tubo-ovarian mass. These are the perihepatic adhesions or violent string adhesions known as Pitts-Hurkacz syndrome. These are adhesions of the uterus and the posterior pelvis. According to the Index TB guidelines, that is Indian Extrapulmonary Tuberculosis Guidelines 2016, the diagnosis of female genital tuberculosis should be made based on any one of the following, that is laparoscopic appearance of a typical for female genital tuberculosis, any gynecological specimen positive for AFP on microscopy or positive for Mycobacterium tuberculosis on culture, any gynecological specimen with findings consistent with female genital tuberculosis on histopathological examination. Coming to treatment, the aims of the treatment is to achieve cure, to prevent long-term sequelae, and to restore the normal anatomy if it has been distorted. Besides giving supportive treatment, rest, good nutrition, specific treatment includes antitubercular drugs. Now there are only two categories, category 1 and category 2. Category 1 involves newly detected extrapulmonary tuberculosis, which includes female genital tuberculosis, whereas category 2 involves all the relapses, treatment failures, or who have not responded to the treatment or defaulted. All these cases come in the category 2. Category 1 consists of 6 months of treatment with 2 months of intensive phase of 3 drugs and 4 months of continuation phase of only 2 drugs. Whereas category 2, totally 8 months of treatment with 2 months of intensive phase with the 5 drugs and 1 month with the 4 drugs and 5 months with the 3 drugs. I am not going into detail with the drugs due to time constraint. Treatment success declines rapidly with increasing drug resistance, which can be as high as 83% in sensitive infection to about 28% in extremely drug resistant tuberculosis. Adding to the insult is the dual epidemic of tuberculosis with HIV. Despite enormous gains made in battling the HIV epidemic, the tuberculosis deadly synergy with HIV or AIDS is threatening to destabilize the gains in TB control. While people are living with HIV now, they are dying of tuberculosis. In such a clinical scenario, antiretroviral therapy should be given to the patients in material of their CD4 cell count, and TB treatment should be started first, followed by ART as soon as possible and within first 8 weeks of starting TB treatment. Coming to indications for surgery in female genital tuberculosis, it is done only in case of progression of the disease, persistent active lesion, large inflammatory masses, pyosalpings or pyometra, and persistence of fistula. Coming to contraindications, plastic adhesions of the bowel can lead to injury. Active lesions elsewhere in the body will be flared up if you do a surgery, so defer it. And even after treatment, tuberoplasty is contraindicated because it reactivates the disease, and fertility cannot be restored when tubal walls are damaged, so they will ultimately end up with infertility or ectopic pregnancy, so it is not recommended. Coming to the prognosis and reproductive outcome, though cure rate with chemotherapy is 90%, restoration of fertility is only up to 10%, and out of this, 50% will present with ectopic, 20 to 30% end in abortions, and only 2% live births are noted. And if only tubes are damaged but endometrium is normal, there is a hope with in vitro fertilization embryo transfer, where a successful pregnancy of up to 40% can be given to the lady. Sequelae can be infertility, chronic pelvic pain, ectopic pregnancy, and secondary amenorrhea. Due to time constraints, I am not dealing with pregnancy and tuberculosis. But if any lady who is planning to conceive is diagnosed to have tuberculosis, she should be advised to complete the treatment first and then conceive. Take a proper, follow a proper contraceptive advice to prevent accidental pregnancies. Avoid oral contraceptive pills as contraception, or higher dose should be used. And if diagnosed during pregnancy, anti-tuberculosis treatment should be started. It is safe for both mother and the fetus. If it is diagnosed in the postpartum period, again ATT should be started, and if fetus is affected, even the infant receives the treatment. If the infant is not affected, then INH prophylaxis should be given for 6 months. Breastfeeding is not contraindicated. These are my references.